Prepare for trouble.
And make it double.
To play games with unintended mechanics.
To beat bosses, no matter how gigantic.
We restrict ourselves to secondary weapons.
And make the possibility of it, no question.
Glitch.
Pretty chill.
This duo blasts off at the speed of light.
Bosses back down or prepare to fight.
Wait, we only got two players. There's no third for the ending. Can you beat Remnant from the Ashes with only secondary weapons? The rules are simple. First, we'll start with a new character, but allow account-bound items. Second, we'll play through the entirety of Nightmare difficulty, including the Subject 2923 DLC. There is a difficulty higher than this, but Nightmare is already challenged to run with a fresh character without any other restrictions. Finally, we can only use secondary weapons.
We're not allowing the usage of weapon mods, so we are therefore banning the usage of secondaries you get from bosses like the Spitfire.
While we could use them without triggering their mods, we decided to ban them outright to prevent any accidents from happening. One last thing before we start is a note on how Remnant handles co-op play. You might say that playing co-op is easier, but Remnant attempts to offset this by spawning more enemies, giving them more health, and making them deal more damage, meaning that playing co-op isn't necessarily a benefit and causes a harder strain on each player if one goes down. So, with the rules set, let's roll a new adventure and begin. When making a new character, you get a choice of class, and there's basically only one correct answer for this run, Hunter. Cultist gives us faster mod regeneration, which doesn't apply to us, and while Scrapper is bulkier than Hunter, we start off at a severe damage disadvantage. To give you an idea, we couldn't even take a Root Brute down without both or at least one player using an ammo box, and Hunters will help cut the ammo box grinding down in the early stages as well as be useful later on. Once your class is confirmed, make a pit stop for Elder Knowledge and the SMG at the bottom of the ward. I'll link a guide in case you're not familiar with the locations. Breaking boxes and other destructibles around the ward gives you some bonus starting scrap, letting you do some initial upgrading and purchase ammo boxes. After warping into the first world, it was apparent that the biggest problem we would face would be damage output. Taking the small enemies down was doable, but elites felt almost like a boss on their own. Each little bit of progress would reward more scrap and materials, letting us upgrade our gear just a little more. The extra damage from each level on the pistols especially helped out, making it just a tad easier each time to clear the standard enemies. Both here and in the sewer, you'll want to play fairly strategically and focus on dodging attacks properly. Getting pinned with multiple enemies or trying to tackle a Root Brute instead of running past it will often result in a death this early on. The sewer in particular was quite difficult due to the tighter spacing not allowing us to run past the more difficult elites, and the elites that spawn here are almost a lost cause to even try to fight. If a player goes down or runs out of ammo boxes, the second one needs to deal with the enemies intended for both players on their own. Since we went through ammo boxes at what felt like every corner, it's very worth picking up every bit of scrap material or item you can find, since this run required a massive amount of items and gear upgrades. The last thing I'll mention about the overworld is that if you have Loop of Prosperity, it'll cut down the grinding quite significantly for the materials. We probably won't go over the rest of the overworld area as much, except for a specific scenario or two, as what most of you are here for are the bosses.
For Earth boss number one, we happen to roll Gorefist, and happen to get the Hardy modifier, which really sucks since damage output was our biggest issue here. For gear, we chose the Hunter set, Repeater Pistol, Gunslinger's Charm, Burden of the Gambler, and Ring of Evasion, with equipment being plus 10.
You might wonder how we got to plus 10. Well, this boss was certainly doable at plus 5, but required significant amounts of ammo boxes, and was an extremely lengthy fight at plus 5. So we decided to allow Adventure Mode to grind scrap and experience as needed. However, Adventure Mode could give equipment that we wouldn't have had access to yet in a normal playthrough, so we added an extra stipulation for Adventure, stating that we could not run planets we didn't have access to or move past bosses we hadn't already beaten. One side effect of running adventures that it started giving us the crafting material required to get about plus 5, and after talking we decided to allow ourselves plus 10 for this boss, but not any higher.
Back to equipment for a minute. If you have account bound items, it would really help for this fight, especially equipment like the Empowering Loop or White Rose, helping deal a bit more damage. While we ran the Repeater Pistol, we experimented with the Magnum Revolver and would consider it viable for this boss, but SMG, our only other alternative at this point, did not perform well here. There are a lot of strategy guides for Gorefist and other bosses online, so we didn't feel like it's worth talking about specific attacks. That said, there are a few things special to this run. If you don't run to plus 10 like we did, taking down the Rotworts is going to be particularly tough. It's crucial to communicate when they spawn and which ones are chasing who. Technically, you can lead them to Gorefist and they will explode dealing damage to him, but unless both players are rolling in sync with each other, that is likely to damage or kill the other one. We recommend splitting focus so that one person is dealing with the Rotworts and the other one is dealing with Gorefist if possible. Since Root Mother isn't unlocked yet, you're stuck doing this boss with only 3 Dragon Hearts, which needed to be balanced between reviving your teammate or healing yourself. Bloodwort can help, but we weren't really tanky enough to survive many hits to begin with, so it's not a great item to rely on here. One final note for strategy. If one player goes down, the other player will likely get overwhelmed and have a difficult time reviving them. To make this easier, you can run up to the top, jump out of the window when Gorefist gets close. Since he can't follow you as quickly, you will have more time to revive your friend. In terms of difficulty, I would say this one is definitely up there for the run due to the restricted gear that we had access to and our lack of Dragonheart upgrades.
Not exactly a boss, but Encounter 2 on Earth will always be Root Mother, a 2-minute fight requiring you to defend the Root Mother against standard enemies and elites. In terms of build, pretty much anything goes here. Whatever gear you've been running in the overworld, barring the Loop of Prosperity, which you probably want to swap for Ring of Evasion or something to grant more damage. The first minute of the fight is pretty easy with standard adds and archer elites. If you have decent power and aim, the archers should be easy enough to steal their aggro from the Root Mother and take them down. For the second minute, it mostly becomes a balance of grabbing enemy aggros and trying to survive. Since the timer isn't super long, this isn't the most difficult section. Definitely don't focus on taking the big guys down. Take out the smaller adds or archers if possible and just let the Root Brutes try to hit you. Overall, this encounter wasn't too difficult and only took about 15 minutes to clear successfully. With this one down, you can finally buy Dragon Hearts, giving us options to have more revives and heals going forward. Before moving on to the world boss on Earth, I wanted to point out that we got the Bandit set encounter. I'd highly recommend getting the set. Essentially, it gives your shots a chance to not consume ammo, and since the most frequent thing we farmed was ammo boxes, this reduced grinding a bunch over the course of the run.
A world boss on Earth was Singe. Dealing with the equipment constraints of Earth's drops, we came up with Bandit's Armor, Magnum Revolver, Gunslinger's Charm, Ring of Evasion, and either the Ring of Flawless Beauty or Braided Thorns. The decision mostly comes down to how frequently you're hitting weak spots. If you find it difficult to hit weak spots, opt for the Braided, but if not, the Ring of Flawless Beauty will give you a better damage boost. Bandit's Armor might seem like a bit of a weird choice here, but since the adds are emulators, ammo is scarce. We didn't want to have to grind out ammo boxes for every couple attempts, so Bandit's was the way to go for this boss. For Singe, one person should focus on grabbing the aggro of the boss while the other one focuses on the immolators. In our attempts, the immolators would automatically aggro to whoever is closest, so the person dealing with them needs to shoot them once to redirect them. If you're playing 2 players like us, 2 immolators should spawn every little bit, and if you don't grab both, the player focused on Singe would easily get overwhelmed. We adopted a strategy of staying on the opposite side of the map and cycling in the same direction around the arena. This helps keep Singe's aggro on the same person and prevented its attacks from overlapping and hitting both players. This one didn't feel quite as difficult as Gorefist, nor did it take as many attempts. We suspect this is mostly due to us being able to utilize strategy and juggle aggro between the players, preventing us from being overwhelmed and knocked down as frequently.
Clearing Singe unlocks the labyrinth of the next world, which is Rom, a desert with quite the bulky enemies, and I did want to point these out. These guys take a lot of shots to take down, so it's probably not in your best interest to fully clear each area, or you might wind up wasting multiple ammo boxes just to progress through a single chunk of the map. Once again, make use of Bandit's Armor to help reduce bullet consumption, and generally try to avoid the elites if possible, even going as far as sneaking through some sections.
Boss 1 on ROM is Scourge, and Scourge killed us a lot. Our final build was actually split, so each player had different gear.
For my side, I focused on Scourge himself and wound up running the Bandit set, Hunting Pistol, Gunslinger Charm, Burden of the Gambler, and Stockpile Circlet. Burden of the Gambler might seem a bit strange since he has a weak spot, but hitting the hive causes projectiles and I was heavily focused on not taking damage since we were only at plus 15 gear.
Over on my side of the field, my build was focused towards juggling the adds. I ran Bandit Set, Hunting Pistol, Aggressor's Bane, Eslan's Bane, and Pocket Watch. Scourge's aggro will stay focused on one player if the other player leaves him alone, and the other player can focus on keeping the adds away from the Scourge killer. Thanks to this random comment on Effects for Life, they learned that if you leave a single add alive, no others will spawn. So I would keep the final adds aggro with Aggressor's Bane and lead him away from Glitch.
As we did with Singe, the idea was to circle the stadium on opposite sides to keep the small guys and Scourge from overlapping and accidentally causing them to swap aggro.
The moment we started juggling the aggro like this, we went from dealing less than a quarter of Scourge's health to well over half in each attempt.
But it wound up being kind of pointless. One of the times we started, the boss spawned inside of the ground. So yeah, it took a lot of bullets, but without the stress of the boss himself, it was definitely easier. Not really sure what caused this, but we took it and moved on. Our world boss for Rom was the Claviger, and compared to Scourge, he was significantly worse. Build for this one required us to farm an account-bound item on our other characters and level up Exploiter to 20. Hunter set, Hunting Pistol, White Rose, Empowering Loop, and Stockpile Circlet was the final set we settled on after a lot of spreadsheet calculations. The main reason for this was to be able to take down the Anointed before they killed us. As soon as you enter the fight, run underneath Claviger. He always starts with a shield phase plus orb projectiles, and anytime he is using the orb attack, you are completely safe if you stand directly under him. After this phase, he'll start to spawn adds, and each player should look in opposite directions, one left and one right. If you play two people like us, he will either spawn two or four adds. If he spawns two, simply take them down and don't move positions, but if he spawns four, run out. These things are the reason we needed to farm a countbound, as they can take you down quite quickly and have a lot of health compared to the damage secondaries deal. If four spawn, stay spread further out until they are down and then get back underneath him immediately. The only other time you should run out from under Clav is when he does his beam attack. This attack will target one player, figure out who it is and have them run out to keep it off the second one. This attack lets you get pretty good damage in, so take advantage of it and shoot where possible. At 1/3 and 2/3 health respectively, he will slam the table and spin it. If you ammo box before he hits the ground, it'll continue to refill your ammo while you're suspended. One important bit of information is that if he spawns adds while you're inside of a shield, you can stay in his shield and shoot them as they can't shoot through it while you can. Stay underneath him and pick the closest ones off first before taking his shield down. The strategy sounds straightforward, but this boss was a significant pain due to the anointed that he spawns as they consistently killed us. We actually mapped this one down to the amount of damage we dealt to the shield elements and anointed, and the amount of bullets required to take Clav down, which, fun fact, is 79 if you don't get any crits. It took us 5 weeks to clear Claviger, and you can tell just how excited we were when we finally cleared it.
It's three shots. One more. Do it. It's dead. Oh, holy sh. Oh my god.
At the end of ROM, you encounter the Undying King and an interesting question. Kill him or don't? If you kill him, you skip the entire world of Corsus, or alternately, you have to trek through Corsus and beat two more bosses. We decided to trek to Corsus to grab the Executioner trait and get the Slayer set. This is definitely not necessary, but we expected we might need the trait and gear for later bosses due to how much we struggled already at this point. For the first Corsus boss, the Unclean One was our role. For build, we actually didn't have a set build and ran slightly different gear. Bandit set, hunter pistol, stockpile circlet, empowering loop, and white rose was what I took, and pretty much similar to PrettyChill set. The important note for this fight is to do the alt kill. The normal fight spawns a lot of adds, and this is way more work than is needed in our run. Run downstairs and hide in the pots to get a secondary fight where no adds spawn, but his moveset is a little bit harder to dodge. The one thing I would like to point out that we didn't find in the guides is that when he does this ground slam attack, the number of strikes is not consistent. It's usually 4, but can be more or less than that. Overall, this encounter was pretty easy and didn't take us too long to clear, not even requiring many ammo boxes as there was a decent amount of ammo around the stadium.
Boss 2 in Corsus was the Thrall one, and just like Scourge, we opted for another split build choice. I dealt with the adds and opted for running Leto's armor, hunting pistol, Leto's amulet, Aggressor's Bane, and Ezlan's Band, going for a full bulk build instead of a damage focused one.
As for my setup, I ran bandits for refund, hunting pistol, white rose, stockpile circlet, and empowering loot for a balance of damage and ammo consumption and capacity.
Just as with Scourge, you can take down all but one add and no more will respawn. One nice thing about this guy is though is that if you aim your gun at him after he attacks, he'll jump back, giving you a bit of time to heal or take a break from dodging. As for dealing with Thrall himself, his attacks are quite straightforward, and his weak spot is in the back of his head. One of his attacks will send corrosion beams from the ground below you and will try to hit both players, so it's best to call it out if you notice it. This one didn't give us much trouble and honestly didn't take that many reattempts.
And as expected, Ixillis is the world boss of Corsus, and only one you can roll. Before we get into build, I just want to say that there's a bit of a lack of info, and we did quite a lot of calculation for this boss, and it took us around 13 builds before finding one that worked. We found a spreadsheet in the official Discord server to help view boss numbers and learn how damage works, but for this boss, the sheet wound up not giving us the full picture, so we ran the calcs by hand, going as far as to slow-mo our footage to get the exact number to tackle Ixillis. For builds, we ran separate gear, but as far as we could tell, these were the only viable paths. I ran Hunter Set, Magnum Revolver, White Rose, Empowering Loop, and Ring of Flawless Beauty.
The other build we found that worked was what I ran. This entails swapping out Hunter Set for Ossius and swapping the Magnum out for the Repeater.
Ixillis is a tough boss regardless of restriction, but with a secondary restriction, the main issue is preventing his scream phase. We had some success using Leto's to tank it and only break one side, but could not get a run together using that strategy, so we opted for breaking both instead. The builds we have are specifically optimized so that one person can break each. A note about the Magnum Revolver build though. This was my go-to, but if you're replicating this run and setup, it is critical you interrupt the reload on the Magnum Revolver after 2 or 3 bullets in order to break Ixillis' scream in time. The downside to running Magnum is actually where Repeater outshines it, and that's for the orbs that Ix creates. Since Repeater gets more bullets in a clip and fires faster, it's easier to deal with the orbs. These don't have a damage barrier, so any bullet would take them down. The difficulty comes in working together on these. Our strat was one person take each side for the orbs and communicates when Ixillis starts heading back to the stand and whatever moves are coming next. The most consistent part we died on was the scream though, and this move deserves some more conversation. Our strategy was to group up together towards the center of the stadium so that one of us could frenzy dust and help increase the chance of breaking these. With secondaries, you can only barely take these down before Ixillis screams, and it's imperative you get frenzy dust out before the timer starts and as many shots in as possible. If you run split builds like us, the Magnum player should also be ready to assist the Repeater player in this phase. While it's not strictly required for a win, I suggest breaking open the cocoon of the second Ixillis immediately upon entering the fight. It deals 25% damage to its health and shaves some time off the fight. Overall, this boss was an actual nightmare for us to overcome and required us to play almost completely perfectly, making essentially any mistake ending an attempt. This is one of, if not the hardest boss in the entire run, rivaling the difficulty we had on Claviger.
Which is pretty ironic considering that you can just skip this boss by taking out the Undying King, and the Undying King was the next boss we took down. For Undying, there's not a specific build, but we do have some recommendations. High damage is good here, so for reins and amulets, focus on it. But for armor, you can run bandits over hunter or slayer if you want to preserve some ammo. Additionally, the guns that have more stagger, like the magnum or hunting pistol, are recommended with dealing with the adds. We didn't have many reattempts or needed to come up with a big strategy, but one thing we noticed helped was staying around the top platform. When the adds spawn, they have to funnel up through the stairs and it makes dealing with them easier. After the adds are down, you can dodge off to the side to force the Undying King to spend time walking around to get you. Other than that, there's not a lot of specific strategy here, and this is one of the easier bosses we face in the entire run.
With Corsus and Rom's saga finally over, we get to the final world, Yaesha, and our first event was the Risen. No build recommendation here, in fact, there's not even a struggle. Turns out the internet found out easy ways to deal with this one already. Stare at the ground as you move around the map till you find the reanimators, then only look up to destroy them. Once destroyed, look down again and move on to the next one, and as long as you do so, no enemies spawn, meaning you have no struggle whatsoever. There was one interesting thing though we found at this point in the run, which is that if you press the reload button immediately after firing the hunting pistol, you can get a significantly faster reload. In fact, this works with all guns, but it's way more noticeable with the hunting pistol as it shaves a chunk of time off the reload and might even make it viable for Ixillis. And following that, it's guaranteed you'll get the Rebel event. This is the build that I ran, but Ring of Evasion can be pretty good here if you're having trouble with the dodges. Also recommended is to run one of the higher damaging guns like Magnum or Hunting Pistol to help stagger and fast kill the smaller enemies. Overall, this event is pretty straightforward and we didn't need any specific strats to take it down. If anything, it's worth taking down the small enemies before dealing with the elites, as the less numbers make the fight less stressful. Finally, a boss shows up in Yaesha, and it's Stormcaller. Unfortunately, we rolled the regenerator modifier and underestimated it on our first few attempts, assuming it would be easy. Once again, we're opting for split builds. My setup was Leto's armor, Leto's amulet, Aggressor's Bane, Eslen's band, and Magnum Revolver.
My side was focused on damage, so I picked the Hunting Pistol, Slayer set, White Rose, Empowering Loop, and Burden of the Gambler. Since Stormcaller doesn't have any weak spots, Burden of the Gambler is a better choice over Flawless Beauty. But any high damage build we've mentioned, or one that you're able to put together at this point, would work.
The main thing with Stormcaller is to make sure the Leto's player is making use of Aggressor's Bane to aggro the adds that spawn and take them down. With the bulk, it's not too bad if you get hit, just try to stick close to the other player when they spawn so you can redirect any enemies that aren't the boss. Note that unlike the other fights where we've kept a single enemy alive, it doesn't seem to work here, so definitely take the adds down as you can. The boss itself doesn't have any weak spots or crazy attacks, so it's pretty straightforward for the person focusing on it. Hiding behind the columns for some cover makes for a pretty good strat for fighting the main boss, and hanging towards the intro gate is a good idea too. Overall, Stormcaller was a pretty fair fight and doesn't prove too difficult for the restrictions in this run. Mostly the secondaries just make it take longer to take down.
One boss left before the world boss of Yaesha, and that's the Root Horror. For build, I'd go with the highest damage one you can make. Ours looks something like Slayer set, Hunting Pistol, White Rose, Empowering Loop, and Grim Coil. We only had a few retries here, so the build isn't critical. The main priority should be taking down the adds before focusing on the boss. This is actually one of our fastest boss kills, going down in just over a minute.
We didn't need to deal with a world boss since the wolf was what spawned for us. You see, if you hit the bells in a specific order, you can completely skip this boss. Since we're not allowing boss legendaries, we skip this and save some pain. With all the base game worlds clear, it's time for the final boss, the Dreamer. The setup for this one is a single build, but you'll want two guns. For the main set, run Slayers, Hunting Pistol, White Rose, Braided Thorns, and Empowering Loop. However, you'll also want to have powered up SMG ahead of time.
There's not split strategy here, and the first phase is very straightforward. If you split up and get headshots with the fast reload Strat and Hunting Pistol, you can take down the first phase by forcing his aggro to redirect after each shot. Doing this means we got the first phase down in literally under 30 seconds.
Since we had to boost a crit chance from Braided Thorns and the Executioner trait, we crit most shots and dealt almost 3,000 with a headshot. For phase 2, we constantly got destroyed.
And honestly, it was looking kinda grim.
See, the main issue was that we couldn't take the armor down no matter how many stacks we got. Getting around 10 wasn't an issue, but getting further was a no-go due to root brute spawning.
That's when our chat made a suggestion that led us to some info we hadn't considered before.
Have you tried using a fast firing weapon?
Yeah, as it turns out, the damage these stacks give as bonus is not multiplicative when dealing damage to a shield. When hitting the shield with the hunting pistol with 10 stacks, the damage is around 30,000, so you'd think the SMG would do considerably less, but it's actually doing 12,000 to 13,000 per bullet.
With the SMG, you can destroy the shield insanely fast, and using the hunting pistol, we couldn't even break it.
There is one more catch to this, though. After a shield is down, you'll notice that the SMG does considerably less than the hunting pistol. The stacks go away after you break a shield, and the hunting pistol numbers are significantly better once the shield is down. So in short, as you exit the realm where you fight Gyad, swap to SMG to break a shield. Technically only one person needs to use the SMG to break a shield, so we opted for one person to stay with hunting pistol while the other swaps. Once we learned this bit of info, honestly, Dreamer wound up being really easy, so thank you to my mod Rocky for mentioning that we should try a fast firing weapon. The base game is complete, but this run's not over yet. We mentioned we'd tackle the Subject 2923 DLCs, so here we go. Boss 1 of the DLC for us was Ikro the Ice Conjurer. Build here is Slayer Set, Hunting Pistol, White Rose, Grim Coil, and Empowering Loop. The main strat is to circle around the stadium, keeping away from the ice clouds, which is certainly not a new strat. The main difference from a regular playthrough comes with the summoned ice. In two players, the walls you can hide behind will actually break before you can destroy the ice if both players stand behind the same one, so we split up to spread out the damage from the icicle spears. If you've not got at least half your ammo left when the ice sphere comes in, then use a box before it starts shooting. If you need to use one during the ice sphere phase, the wall you're hiding behind will break before you can do enough damage to break the sphere. This one wasn't too bad since it didn't require a lot of building and just mostly comes down to learning the fight better.
Vargr and Brudvaak is next, and with our run, there really wasn't much special here. We use the same build as Ikro, but if dodging him isn't your jam, there's no reason you can't run Leto's. We found it easier to take Vargr down first, and then 1v1 Brudvaak, but this fight didn't require any special strategy and wasn't different than a normal run.
Obryk is up next, and once again there's not a correct build. I opted for our previous Leto's build with Hunting Pistol and used Rock of Anguish instead of Leto's Amulet and Alchemist Ring for maximum bulk, while PrettyChill went for the damage setup. Personally, I'm not great at fighting this boss, so I wanted to just try and pop Bloodwort without even needing to dodge. We didn't get a lot of attempts in on this boss, so we didn't settle on a strategy because, well, this happened.
Sir?
Please sir? Be broken, please be broken, please be broken, please be broken, please. I think he's broken.
Sir?
I did a bit of digging into this in post, and I was able to find another video of someone who hit this glitch as well. To my knowledge, this is multiplayer specific and has to deal with the move where he holds his shield in front of him and charges at you. My best guess is that if the person who he is charging at loses aggro or runs up to him, he just stops and doesn't know what to do from there. This is definitely something that could be reproduced because we hit it again while running survival mode together. If anyone knows more or experiments that confirms the cause, I would love to see it in the comments. But for completeness sake, I'd say either the damage setup or Leto's is valid here even if you don't hit the glitch.
For the finale, it's none other than the Root Harbinger himself, Harsgaard. Before we talk about build, we have a prerequisite for this fight. Go into your settings and change your FOV to max. We had issues reading the final phase of this boss, and the FOV increase made a huge difference. For builds, we actually have two, but not due to split strategy. The first build is Slayer Set, Hunting Pistol, White Rose, Aggressor's Bane, and Empowering Loop. You could certainly swap Aggressor's Bane for Ring of Evasion in the first phase, but it'll come into play in a minute. We both ran this build for phase 1, and ultimately, phase 1 is really straightforward. Secondary only doesn't impose any new restrictions to this phase, and there's no specific strats for our run.
For phase 2 though, we hot swap builds as the phases changed. Swap the Slayer set for Leto's armor, and White Rose for Leto's amulet. This is the main reason we led with Aggressor, so we didn't have as many pieces of gear to swap during the phase change. With the bulkier build and increased armor, the second phase should become a lot more doable. It's certainly possible to do this without the hot swap, but on Nightmare difficulty, you're pretty much one shot in the second phase, so without the swap, it has to be played pretty much perfectly. In terms of damage, the drop off from switching to Leto's isn't too terrible because we maxed out the Mindsight trait we got from beating Dreamer. Once we adapted the hot swap Leto strat, we instantly won on our first attempt after struggling for quite some time using a single build. And with that, the secondary Nightmare challenge is complete. While there is potential to complete this game on the highest difficulty, this run was a significant challenge for our mostly fresh character run. If there's enough interest in the highest difficulty, we'll consider kicking it up once again and seeing what bosses this affects and if we can break the damage barrier on Ixillis. For now, this run was a bunch of fun, and I want to thank PrettyChill for running this with me. If you liked this run, consider dropping a like, or if you're interested in other out-of-the-box runs, subscribe to check out other upcoming content. I'm Glitch the Box Links, and I'll see you in the next Out of the Box Challenge.